church. I invite everyone to stand to their feet. Come on, put your hands together like this. Come on, we haven't sang this song in a while. Let's sing this out together.
From the highest throne to the earth below, you lay down your life for the likes of us. Great is the love of the Savior. From the wounded heart to a life made whole, every human heart will declare as one. Great is the love of the Savior.
Sing it out together.
Lord of endless life, let your glory shine forever. All the earth will sing your praise. From the mountain height to the valleys low,
church. I hope you guys are feeling good. You guys feeling good? There we go. Well, listen, well, let's raise a hallelujah in this place. Come on, in the presence of our enemies. Come on, let's raise a hallelujah. Come on, Paul, take it away. Sing us.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief.
Come on, come before you, Lord Jesus. Father God, we come before you just as we are. Father God, we come. We come to meet with you. We come to know you. We come to put our hope and trust in you. God, we come to give you everything. So God, accept our worship this morning. We love you. In Jesus' name we all pray. We say amen. Come on, let's sing this together, church. God, some praise in this place from our hearts. God, we raise a hallelujah, God. We ask him to come. We ask him to move with power. And what we're hoping is that as we raise a hallelujah, as we lift our voices together, that God may decide to move on our behalf. Amen? It would be awesome if we all sing together, right? And it would sound so, so pretty, so beautiful. If every voice in this room would join this anthem, it would sound awesome. But what would be more awesome is if not only our voices, but our hearts and our affections and our desires actually join forces and hopefully move the heart of God. Anybody want to move the heart of God in this place? Come on. I want God to move in my life. Come on, so let's all join together. Let's sing this out. Because all I know.
Thank you.
sing it again.
And with everything within me, I will worship you.
Come on, and with everything, declare this.
And with everything within me, I will worship you.
One more time, and with everything, declare this.
And with everything within me, I will worship you, my God.
Take a moment, a personal moment, on your own, and cry out to your God. Take your moment, church. So God, we're here as individuals, but also as a whole, as a body, God, asking you to move in our behalf, asking you, God, to do what only you can do, and that is transform a person's life from the inside out. God, we desperately want to meet with you. We could be anywhere else, God, right now, doing something else. But God, we have chosen, we have made a decision to put our attention, our affection. We have positioned ourselves in a place, God, where hopefully, God, we can experience and encounter the presence of the living God. God, we know that your truth is going to be presented and preached to us. God, we know that your truth is going to move in our midst. Your spirit is going to move in our midst. And hopefully, God is going to liberate us, change us, God, intervene into our situation. So what we ask, God, is that as we position ourselves, focus, align, and hopefully get involved in worship and note-taking and the vision you have for this church, God, that you may do something special in our homes, in our hearts, in our minds, in our families, God, in our workplaces, and wherever we might find ourselves. God, we want you to move radically, powerfully in our lives. So God, speak to us. Open up our ears, God. Soften our hearts. Speak to us, God. We desire nothing else but you. We love you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. We all say it. Everyone, come on. Amen. Put your hands together for God. Come on, give him some praise. Raise a hallelujah. Amen. Well, welcome to Enemy Church. We're so happy that you guys are here. Let's take the next 30 seconds and make sure that we welcome one another. Make sure you guys feel part of the family. Come on, church.
How's everybody doing today? Man, it's so great to see all of you guys, man, gathered here worshiping our God, man. Man, I want to welcome all of our first-time guests. If you are visiting us here today for the very first time ever, we want to welcome you in a special way. So Elevate Church, on the count of three, let's welcome our guests. One, two, three, come on. Yeah. Welcome. Whoever you are, man, know that you're always welcomed here at Elevate Church, man. We gather here to worship a big God, man, and to just pour our lives before him, man. So welcome. You're in the right place. Now, if you are our guest today, we want to know more about you, man. We want to welcome you in a special and a personal way. So I'm asking you guys to grab one of these connection cards from the backs of the chair in front of you. Take some time throughout the service to fill it out. Put on there some of your basic information, as much as you feel comfortable with. And at the end of the service, as you're exiting, look for a red tent, and we're going to ask you guys to turn it into the red tent. We're going to exchange your filled out card with a free gift and a packet. It's our way of saying thank you for being our guest. And we're also going to, you know, just give you guys a Bible if you don't have one, in English or in Spanish. If you don't have a Bible in your home, we want to place one in your hands. So give us the opportunity to welcome you on a personal level here at Elevate Church. So our guest, man, please do us a favor and fill it out. And at the end of the service, drop it off. Now, everybody else that's part of Elevate Church home, welcome back. Give yourselves a hand as well. It's great to be with family. Know that you are loved, right? We're family. We're doing this together. Remember, focused, aligned, right, and involved in everything that God has here at Elevate Church. Let's take a couple of seconds, man, and let's pray. And let's ask God to speak to us through His revealed written word. We're going to open up God's word. That is where God reveals Himself. Every time we open up God's word, there's an opportunity for Him to change your life. So let us pray. Father, we pray that You would speak in a powerful way right now, God. Have Your way in our services, God. We love You. God, I pray if there's anyone here that does not know You, God, I pray that today they will trust You as their Savior. They will know that You have created them, Father, with a purpose, God, and You have a plan for their lives. So, Father, I pray that You would move mightily as we lean in, Father, and lend You our ears, God, and our hearts. And I pray if there's anyone, God, that is just dealing with something, God, carrying a heavy burden, I pray that today You would meet their need. Father, we love You and we thank You. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen, church. Put our hands together for our God. I want to start off asking real quick, man. How many of you or your kids have Legos at home? How many of you have Legos at home? I know that a lot of us have Legos at home. How many of you, your kids absolutely love Legos? Raise up your hand if your kids absolutely love Legos. Mine do too, right? How about when you were a kid? When you were a kid, how many of you loved Legos when you were a kid? I know I did. I loved that. I remember the time that Happy Meals were actually Happy Meals, and they would actually make you happy, and the toy was actually pretty good. When I was a kid, they would give little Lego packs, and I used to love going to McDonald's just to get the Lego packs. Now they have, whatever, nothing of value, anything good for my kids, right? But man, I loved the Legos when I was a kid, but then I became a parent. And when you become a parent, you begin to hate Legos, right? Let me ask parents, see if you're with me. How many of you have stepped on a Lego in the middle of the night? A sharp piece, you know, like, you know, a sword, a lightsaber, sticking up, you know, you look up and little Lego Thanos is looking at you, you know, got you. Man, how many times has that happened? You begin to hate Legos, man. So I've developed a love-hate relationship with Legos. And I have two main reasons why. Number one, I think that Legos are way too expensive. How many of you agree? It's way too much money. Like, man, like this one, I don't know how much this one costs. I think my mother-in-law bought it for my kids, and I'm grateful for that because this is a pricey one. But this, I think, I mean, how much was this? You know, this was expensive, like $60, $70 for this thing. There's some $75 actual retail price. $75, the price is right. Din, 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 din. ADD moment, sorry about that. But anyways, man, here, this thing is like $75. There's some that are $100, $150. Like, my kid made a Santa list, and he wanted all the expensive Legos, and I'm like, man, your Santa is not my Santa. I'm sorry, you know. You have a Hialeah Santa. Whatever that looks like. But anyways, so, man, I believe that Legos are way too expensive. Plus, when it doesn't even come built. It doesn't, you have to build it yourself. Shouldn't we get a discount if we have to put it together? You know, like get it together, Lego. No pun intended. Get it together, right? So, man, they're too expensive. Another reason why I hate Legos a little bit, you know, is because it takes so long to build it. So tedious, you know. Page one, get this little piece, put it there. Okay, next up. And it's like, you're there an hour and you build like a chair or a wheel. And it's like, man, you're there forever putting this stuff together, man. It's like you're paying money to build IKEA furniture. Like, same thing. Legos, IKEA furniture, same thing. If your kids love Legos, they have a beautiful job at IKEA waiting for them when they become older, right? They're going to be the best. It's like that. It's a, you know, you're paying money for this. So here's my question. How is it that our kids love Legos so much? Like, why do they love Legos? Like, is it the work? And sometimes it takes weeks to build one. And I know in my house, they give up. And they're like, I have to finish it for them, right? You know? And so think about it. Why do they love Legos so much? Here's my theory. I believe they love Legos so much because look at this box. Look at that picture, bro. Who wouldn't want that thing? Like, you can build that. Like, I mean, look at these little guys fighting and the little pieces and this thing. Like, does that thing fly for $75? It should. Yeah. Electricity coming out. This thing looks really awesome. So kids see it like, Dad, I want that one right there, you know? And of course, it's the picture that gets them, right? It's the picture that gets them. Let me tell you, we're doing this series titled Vision 2020, and we're going over what the vision of Elevate Church is and the mission of Elevate Church. Let me tell you, church, that right there is vision. That's what gets our kids. Vision. It is a picture of the possibilities of what could be. That's what vision is. A picture of what could be. Not necessarily that it is now, but what could be. They buy into what could be. And let me tell you, the same thing in organizations. For us to buy into an organization or into a church, sometimes we need to see a picture of what could be. What's the vision of the church? Does a church have vision? Does it have a goal? Is there something that they would like to see? Vision is what you would like to see. A picture of what could be. That is the same way that the picture gets kids to buy in to this. Vision gets us to buy in into a church or into an organization. We know that God is a God of vision. The Bible says where there is no vision, the people perish. The people perish. This is vision. Now, here's the cool thing about this, right? Because when they look at it, they buy like, I want this, I buy it. And so you buy them this, they take it home. But here's the catch. When you open it, this is not what you're getting. When you open it, you're getting like a bag of parts. That's what you're getting. Like, you got work to do, mom and dad, you know? You're not getting the picture. You're getting the pieces that make... I think I'm missing a bag. Don't tell Louis. No, here it is. I almost lost my fatherhood right now. You are not my dad anymore. So look at this. I mean, this is what you get. You're not getting this awesome toy. You're getting pieces. And you're also getting... this. I mean, this thing is big. $75 big, right? You know, like, so you're getting pieces and you're getting a manual, a book saying, oh, you want that? Get to work. You got some work to do. You open it up and you're like, oh, man. So here it goes. Let the tedious begin, all right? Get that piece and connect it here. That's it. Step one. Step two. Got that piece. Put it there. That's it. Like, at the end of two pages, you only have this. That's it. What's the difference between this and IKEA instructions? No words, pictures, put this here. I mean, I'm telling you, that's all you're getting, you know? This is what you get. You open the boxes, you buy into this, but this is what you get, the work. Let me tell you, we're here unpacking the vision and the mission of Elevate Church. This is the vision, the picture of what you want to see, the picture of the possibility. The manual, this is the mission. This is how you get to this. This is the step-by-step process that gets us into fulfilling the vision. So here's a good statement to understand vision and mission in life, right? The mission is what fulfills the vision. The mission, the step-by-step process, the work fulfills the vision. Now, a lot of people won't buy a book. If my kids saw this instructions, they wouldn't buy into this. A lot of you won't be so excited to serve and do things in an organization when you don't know what the outcome is. What's the purpose? What's the goal? The vision is the why and what we want to see. The mission is the how. How are we going to accomplish this? How are we going to get there? A step-by-step process. Here at Elevate Church, our vision, and I'll show you the next slide, our vision is to see Christ elevated. That's what we want to see. At Elevate Church, we want to see Christ elevated here in Miami-Dade County. That means that people are coming to Christ and lifting up the name of Jesus Christ on high. That's what we want to see. That's our dream of reaching our community for Christ and beyond. That's what we want to see. That's the end game, right? What we want to see at the end. How do we get there? Our mission statement. A three-step process. Step number one, connecting people to Christ. Going in sync with the Legos and the connection. Connecting people to Christ. Step one. Growing in Christ. Step two. And serving Christ. Step three. And we believe here at Elevate Church that if we are all about, if we are focused, aligned, and we're involved in the mission of the church of connecting people to Christ, all of us together, growing in Christ together, and serving Christ together, we believe that we can see Christ elevated in our city and beyond. Today, I want to zero in on our first step of our mission statement, connecting people to Christ. What does that mean? What does that mean? Connecting people to Christ. Another way that I could put it, when we talk about connecting people to Christ, we are talking about connecting people who are far from God, living in this world, who don't have a relationship with God, connecting people who are far from God into a close relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ. Other people call it evangelism, okay? Going out there and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, connecting people who are far from God into a close relationship with Jesus Christ. And all of this starts off with a problem. Why do we need to be connected with God? Why are we distant from God? That brings me to point number one. Point number one, it all starts with a problem. The problem is that humanity is separate from God. Humanity is separate from God. And that we find this all in the book of Genesis. The book of Genesis is the book of origins. We find the origin of life and of creation. We find the origin of mankind. We find the origin of marriage. We find the origin of sin and death and where that came from. All of that is found in just the first three chapters of the first book of the Bible. And it all starts off with first verse of Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. Genesis 1, 1 says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's where it all starts. And let me tell you, this is a fundamental verse for all Christians to believe. Because if we can't settle this, and us as a church, if we can't stand for this, if we can't believe that God created all this stuff, everything that we see, then we can't believe any other verse in the Bible. If we can't believe the first verse of the Bible, then what makes you think you're going to believe the rest of it? And that's why it's so important that we stand with the truth in terms of the origin of mankind and creation, and that we stand against the theories of evolution and the Big Bang theory and atheism that's sweeping, that is teaching our children otherwise. It's the enemy trying to rip God off of society. It all starts off with God as our creator. If he's not our creator, then we can run wild and do whatever we want. But since we have a creator, a designer, an architect, now we have to submit our lives to him. So God created all of mankind. Genesis chapter 1:1. God created an amazing earth. God created us to be in relationship with him. If you look here, man and God standing together, walking in the garden. God, this was God's desire. He created an amazing earth where we had a relationship with him. He dwelt among us. There was no sin. There was no death. There was no sickness, right? There was no corruption. It was a perfect place with perfect harmony between God, man, and the creation. And in Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, then God, when he saw on the sixth day everything he had created, he said that it was very good. Do you imagine paradise? God and man walking together, no corruption, no sin, no death, no sickness, no tears. You imagine that place? That was God's purpose and design for us. That is what he wants for us and nothing else. God created us good, and it's important for us to understand that. And that's what he desires. But something happened. We see in the Bible, in Genesis chapter 3, that Satan entered this creation in the form of a serpent, and he lured humanity away from God by tempting them with sin. The serpent went to Adam and Eve, and went to Eve specifically, and tempted her to partake of the forbidden fruits, the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. And says, man, if you partake of this, you will be like God and have knowledge of good and evil. And her eyes lit up. Oh, I wanna. He tugged out at the human pride, and the human heart couldn't take it and took and bit of that fruit. Adam followed suit. And humanity had now disobeyed God for the very first time. And that is called in the Bible the fall of man. That is where man fell from this perfect relationship that we had with God because of our own sin. The fall of man was an event that took place in the beginning in which man, by his free choice, sinned against God and brought sin into the human race. And everything changed in that perfect world. Let me tell you a couple of things, a couple of the results of the fall of man. Number one, we're born with the stain of sin. Psalms chapter 51, verse 5 says that we are born with the stain of sin, even from birth. That's why we don't have to teach our kids how to say mine. We don't have to teach our kids how to lie. That stuff comes default from factory. Right? They know. We got to teach them how to say please and thank you. And we have to teach them how to share. We have to purposely teach them not to lie. They know that all by themselves. Humanity is born with the stain of sin after that event. Death is another result of the fall of man. Romans 5:12 talks about that death is the result. A cursed earth, Genesis chapter 3, verse 17 through 18. Let me tell you a little bit about what God did that day. He cursed the serpent and he cursed the ground, but he did not curse mankind. So even in the garden, God has grace. But he cursed the ground. You know what that means? That this earth is not what it used to be. It's not the way it was originally created. It is cursed by sin. And now that is why we have natural disasters. That's why there's tsunamis and earthquakes and famines. And that's why there's sickness and cancer and all of these sicknesses and the flu. The flu. All of these things, these natural disasters and sicknesses and death, are all a result of sin. Because the ground is cursed. The earth is cursed. That is not how God intended it. That solves a lot of questions that people may have. Because people say, how can a good God do this to man? God did not do that for us. God created this, a perfect place for us to dwell with him. It was our own brokenness and sin that brought this upon ourselves. So the cursed earth, Genesis 3:19, here's a bad one, right? Hard labor. Our 9-to-5, it's not going to be easy to provide and to eat from the ground. We're going to have to work hard. Another one, sorry ladies, Genesis 3:16 says that another result of the fall of man is painful childbearing. Right? Childbirth for women is very painful, thus the epidural, right? And this is part of the fall. And here's a big one, Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death. Death defined here is separation. Mankind is separated from God because of sin. So Genesis 3:23, the Bible says, so the Lord banished him from the garden. Check this out. The Lord banished him from the garden. And now there was a chasm between God and man that was created by sin. The Lord banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he had taken. Isaiah 59 verse 2 says here, it says, but your iniquities, another word for sin, have made a separation between you and your God. And your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. It is our sin. That's why every Sunday I say the problem between God and man is sin. Very basic that we see in the Bible. Humanity is separate from God. And church, I promise you, this is why life stinks sometimes. This is why we are unhappy at times. This is why there's brokenness in our life. This is why there's injustice in this world. This is why there's struggle. This is why families break apart. This is why children are rebellious. This is why marriages struggle and we fight against each other. The person that we vow to love in front of everyone, the only one that we vow to love is a person we treat the worst. It's a result of sin. It's a result of sin. This is why life is difficult because of our own sin. Who's the first one we blame? Oh God, why are you allowing me to go through this, man? Oh God, it's not God, it's us, man. Sometimes we even blame Satan. Oh, it's Satan. Satan made me do it. No, don't give him so much credit. We got enough broken. Listen, we're bent enough to turn against God. We can sin on our own. We don't need Satan to tempt us so much. We could do it all by ourselves. So the logical thing to do here, mankind, the logical thing for us to do is to try to reach God. Okay, what can we do to bridge this gap? So we turn to religion. Hey, maybe if I go to church, right, I am going to start going to church and I am going to be faithful every Sunday. And this is man's attempt to reach God, but it falls short. Maybe I'm going to be a good person. I'm going to be a good person. I'm not going to do no bad to no one. That's good, but it doesn't go the whole way. It's not good enough. We all fall short, the Bible says, right? Some people say, oh, I'm going to live a moral life. That's called moralism, right? Moralism, I'm going to stay away from sin. I'm going to try to keep the Ten Commandments, and I'm going to be as best as I can. I'm going to behave well all the way to heaven. All of that is called religion. Religion is man's attempt to reach God. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We can't get there on our own. The Bible says in Ephesians 2:8 and 9, it says, by grace that we have been saved, not by works, so that no one may boast. Titus chapter 3, verse 5 says that he saved us not because of the works that were done by us in righteousness, but according to his mercy by the washing and regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit. So, man, we are separate from God, and there is nothing that we can do to get to God. So, listen, what mankind, what humanity that is separate from God needs most is to be connected to God through faith in Jesus Christ. Our first step of our mission statement attempts to solve this issue, to connect people who are far from God into a close relationship with him through faith in his son, Jesus Christ. So since mankind is separate from God, and there's nothing that we can do about it, man, and we try, listen, since mankind couldn't reach out to God, God came down to us. The Bible says that he sent Jesus to save us. So the first problem that we have is humanity is separate from God. But then we talk about provisions. Point number two, here's the provision. Jesus bridged the gap. Jesus bridged the gap. Since we couldn't reach God, God came down to us. And this is the only way to reconcile God to man. This is the only way. There needed to be someone who would die on the cross for our sins, and Jesus was the only one that volunteered and the only one that could do it, Jesus Christ. Romans 5, 6, it says, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. You see, when Jesus died on the cross, he paid for the price for our sins. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. What sin deserves is death. That's the consequence of sin. We couldn't, but since God loved us so much and didn't want to cast us into eternal judgment, he sent his son Jesus, and this is his plan. I'll send my son Jesus. He's holy and perfect and righteous, and he who knew no sin became sin for us so that we can become the righteousness of God. So here, God sent his son Jesus to be a perfect sacrifice on the cross, to die in that place, in our place, so that whoever believes in him, whoever turns away from their sins and turns to Jesus and follows him in faith, all of their sins will be forgiven, the sin will be removed, and they will have eternal life with God. You see, Jesus bridged the gap between God and man. See, when Jesus died on the cross, he went ahead and he made a way where there was no way, and he went and sent his son Jesus, and Jesus died on that cross so that whoever believes in him or will not perish but will have everlasting life. That's why the Bible says in John 14, 6, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father but through Jesus Christ. Jesus made a way for us. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12, verse 13, 12 and 13. Look what it says. Remember, and this is for all of us, remember that at one time, at that time, we were separate from God. We were separate from Christ. We were excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenant of the promise. Look at the words. Focus on the words. Separates, excluded, foreigners. That was all of us before Christ. We were without hope and without God in the world. But look at the very next verse. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus bridged the gap and made a way for us who were far from him into a close relationship with Jesus Christ. Let me tell you, your family, your community, the greatest need that the people we know and love around us that don't know Jesus, their greatest need is to have faith in Jesus Christ. Your kids' greatest needs is for them to have faith in Jesus Christ. It is not a paid-for full-ride scholarship or a Florida prepaid or you to pay for their college or buy them a house or buy them things or toys. What your kids and what our community needs most is faith in Jesus Christ. That's what we need most. And through Christ, we can connect people to God. Jesus is the solution. He is the only hope that humanity has. And we know that. But does the world know that? How do our friends hear about this? Our coworkers, the people that you do life with, your family members, how does our community know this? Well, the problem was that humanity is separate from God. God made a provision, which is Jesus bridged the gap. And now God has a plan. God has a plan, which is point number three. And the plan says the church tells the world about Jesus. This is how we connect the dots. This is how we reach out to other people. You and I, this is where we come in God's plan to save the world. We tell them the good news. We tell them the gospel. We tell them about the hope that we have in Christ. It is our responsibility. The world depends on you, church. So listen, someone tell your neighbor, hey, the world depends on you. Tell them right now. Somebody needs to tell them. You know, and tell them it's your job to tell people about Jesus. Tell them right now. Even point at them. Now, neighbor, return the favor. Your job too. And you got to do it with attitude, all right? Your job too, all right? If you want to snap your finger when you do whatever you got to do. Just make the point clear. I want you to understand that God's plan to save the world was not pastors. It was people. It was people. People. You and I. Same spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in you. You have the same word I have. And all of us are called to tell other people about Christ. And church, if not us, then who? Who? So our first objective as a church, when we think about connecting people to Christ, it's evangelism. It is, as a church, is to connect people to Christ. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus told the believers in Jerusalem, he told them, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere. What does everywhere mean to you? A life group? Oh, you're with your life group and your boys at church or with the ladies, and you tell them, hey, Jesus loves you. What are you going to get? Amen. Yeah. Yeah, amen. Like, you, everywhere is not just church. That means your workplace. That means your schools, young people, your schools. That means, you know, your community, your neighborhood, your family, your dining table. Our first objective is to be witnesses of Jesus Christ everywhere we can. Connecting lost people into a saving relationship with Jesus Christ. And at Elevate Church, I want to be very specific as to how it is that we do this. I mean, very granular, okay? So here it is. There's three things that we do here at our church to connect people to Christ, okay? Number one, we tell. We tell others about Jesus. What do I mean by tell? That means you and I, all of us together, are called to evangelize. To tell other people about Jesus Christ. God called us as individuals to communicate the gospel to everyone around us. You are to tell people, like I said, in your job, hope. Listen, I can't go to your job and preach the gospel and make a calling and an invitation. Hey, trust the Lord. I'm going to get arrested. They're going to tell you your pastor's weird. This guy, you go to that church, that guy's cuckoo, you know? I don't have a relationship or a friendship with the people you work with. Do you believe that maybe, just maybe, God placed you there to do that? Man, let me tell you, growing up, I grew up in West 6th Ave, Hialeah. We were the 6th Ave boys, right? This is not a gang sign or whatever. This is West Coast. I'm just clowning here. Don't jump me in the back, right? But anyways, this is the deal. I was raised in West 6th Avenue, Hialeah. And I remember, I as a kid, I wanted to tell my friends about Jesus. And the first person I reached for Christ, I was 15 years old, man. My backdoor neighbor, good friend of mine, I would preach the gospel. I would tell him, man, as much as I could. He was older than I was. I didn't care. I told him about Christ as much as I could. And I remember leading him to Christ in the driveway of his house on West 5th Place. He was a backdoor neighbor, right? And man, I remember leading him to Christ, and it was a powerful moment because knowing his family and his background and, you know, he's going through some stuff. That's why I'm a little bit, you know. But anyways, some health issues he's going through. But anyways, but man, he gave his life to Christ. And I remember him coming to church, being baptized. And I was like, man, this is awesome. And later on, talking to his grandmother, she was a faithful believer in Christ. His family was far from God. They were far from God. But he was the only one that came to Christ thus far. And man, I remember talking to the grandma, and she was like, man. She goes, you don't know how many years I've been praying for God to, because the house behind them was empty, for God to bring a Christian family to share the gospel with my family. And she goes, I want you to know that you are the answer to the prayer that I've had for many years. And now at least my grandson,
you know, is a believer. I mean, he's grown up and he serves in his church. He shares, like he translates the message and shares the gospel. He's preaching, you know, in his church. I mean, God is really using this man for God's glory, right? Man, let me tell you, God specifically put me on 6665 West 6th Avenue to share the gospel, my friend. Where has God planted you? What job, what cubicle, what school, what desk, what family, what marriage has God put you in the place so that you can be a witness for Jesus Christ? You are probably the answer to someone's prayer. Amen? So church, tell people about Jesus Christ. Listen, sometimes it's a little hard. I know that sometimes you're talking to somebody, a friend or something, and they're coming to you. You know why they're coming to you? Because they see the light of Christ in you. There's something different about you. You have joy, right? And they're like, man, how come this person? And they'll come to you. Man, I'm struggling with this at work. Has it ever happened, right? I'm struggling with this. I'm having a hard time with this. And they'll come to you. And sometimes you're like, okay. And then they start telling you, man, I just feel lost. I'm lacking purpose in my life. And you're like, man, this person needs the gospel. God, I know I need to do it. Like this conversation is like, you know, God is giving you an alley-oop, and he just wants you to slam dunk the gospel, man, and reach it for Christ. Sorry for my ESPN, like thinking, but like God is setting you up for the gospel, and you're like, oh, I don't know what to say. What do I say? Amen, I'll be praying for you, brother, and you leave. Has that ever happened? It's happened to me, right? It happens. That's happened to me. You're sitting on a card that we've prepared at our church. We've had these for many years. We just updated it, refreshed it this weekend and all of last week. This is called the New Life in Christ card. In this card, it shares the gospel, even with a prayer, that you can lead someone to Christ. And it walks you through it, man. It has Bible verses, the same ones that I use, right? Based out of Romans. Let me tell you, 75% or 70% of the text in this card is scripture. I believe the only thing that transforms lives is through the scriptures that God has revealed. Faith comes from hearing and hearing the word of God. You give them the word of God and you trust God's spirit to do the rest. And so here, let me tell you, in hood terms, if you have this, you're strapped with the gospel. And you have a situation that God puts in there, you're ready. You have an arsenal. You're ready to share the gospel with somebody. So men, have these cards with you. Keep them with you. Ladies, in your purse. Men, in your glove compartments, in your desk. If you have a business, put it there. If somebody comes to you hurting, use it. Just give. You could just give it to people. Don't just take one. Take 10. We have 10,000 of these. And they're cheap to print. I'll happily print another 10,000 by next week. So get a bunch and hand them out. You know what my mom does in every stoplight in Hialeah? You know, they're giving, they're selling you something, you know, hey, you know, mamoncillo or peanuts. And they're giving you flyers, right? And if your window's open, they'll just go like that. You know, like, hey, right into your, you know, sorry, I'll take that. You know, sorry about that. They'll drop it in and like, hey, bro, you know. You know what mom does? Okay, I'll take yours, but you got to take mine. My mom's in a drive-thru. She's like a gospel gangster. Right? She's in a drive-thru. She's like, oh, here you go. I got something for you. And all they need to do, this is God's word. Like the Holy Spirit doesn't necessarily need our help. I mean, we have to share the gospel, but his word can do the work. Just give them the card. If you have a relationship with a friendship with them, share the gospel with them. So you can give it to them, or you can read it with them, and you can follow the prayer if you want. You can pray in your own words. There's no hocus pocus here. It's just us calling upon the name of Jesus. So listen, take as many as you can. And another thing, take a picture of it with your phone. You know? So if you lose it, and you have a situation, you have it in your pictures, and go ahead and share it. You could send it to people. Somebody said that. Thank you so much. I didn't even think about that, but you just contribute. I'm going to write that in my sermon right now. Send it. Take a picture. Send it. Post it. I don't know. Whatever it is that God wants to do in your life. But let's make Christ known, man. This is too much of good news for us not to share with the world, right? So number one, we tell others. All of you tell other people, myself included, tell other people about Jesus. Number two, we bring people. We bring people to church on Sundays. I put this as second because a lot of people, they think the first thing is, oh, I want my friends saved. I'm going to take them to church. Like if this is the only way people get saved. No, I want the burden to be on us first to tell. You really don't need to bring them to church. I mean, after they come to Christ, and I do want you to bring them to church. But listen, I want you to bring them to Christ first. And you can do that, right? Number two, then bring them to church. If you haven't found the right words, you don't know, maybe here. Invite as many people. Let's make it not okay from now on to come to church without inviting a friend, without bringing somebody else. Like, let's make that a goal for 2020 and beyond. Like, we're building a new building for this purpose, to bring more people to the presence of God so they can hear the gospel. Like, now, here's my promise. You bring them, and I promise every single Sunday I'm going to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, and I'm going to make an invitation to trust them, because I am committed to sharing the gospel, because I believe it truly is the hope of humanity. So bring them, and we're going to preach the gospel, and we're going to invite them to trust Jesus as their Savior. Last year alone, just counting hands of people that raised their hands, all year, counting Easter, which bumps the numbers, about 900 people made a decision for Christ last year here at Elevate Church, which is pretty powerful. Last year alone, we baptized 74 people here at Elevate Church just last year. Man, that's what it's all about. Reaching people for Christ. So bring them to church. Number three, outreach. This is another way to do it. You tell people about Christ. You bring them to church. Invite from now on. Every Sunday, come back and bring a friend. Number three, outreach. In our church, we have life groups. Small Bible study groups that gather to study God's word. But we don't just get together to study God's word and pray. We actually apply God's word and says, okay, what can we do to reach out to the community? Every small group at Elevate Church is required to prepare a community service outreach project every single semester. So if we have 20 plus groups and three semesters, that's 60 different projects going into our community out every single year. The more groups, the more projects. So man, be part of that. When you, life group leaders that are here, be part of that. Now, let me tell you, that happens all throughout the year. And when we do these projects, we give out New Life in Christ cards. We give out the Elevate Church Cares cards, which ties them to a website that shares the gospel, that invites them to church. Everything is intentional. But there's also once a year, so those happen all the time. They go out to orphanages, prisons. They go to the community. They pass out waters in the community. We do a bunch of different things. Now, once a year, all the life groups, we have something called Love Week and Love Day. Remember how many of you participated last year, right, in Love Week and Love Day? On Love Week, which is the week of Valentine's Day, the week that the world celebrates love, we share the love of Christ by serving people. And Love Day this year is February 15th. Write it down. It's coming up. That's around the corner. That's one day that all of the life groups plan a community service project, and we execute these projects at the same time on the same day. So we all meet at church here together, and then we go out into the community, and it's hundreds of people wearing red shirts, going to businesses, going to the urgent care centers. We're going out into the parks, giving out water. We're cleaning parks. We're up refreshing schools, painting walls, planting gardens, going out into the streets and, you know, just sharing the love of Christ. We have a free car wash here on site, like totally free. Like, people want to give a donation, there's no donation box. And people want to give, like, give it to the church down the street. This is a truly free car wash. We want to share the love of Christ. Christ didn't have a tip jar next to the cross. I got to write that down. That's pretty cool. Hold on. That's pretty cool, man. Now, listen, when we do the car wash this year and somebody says, I want a tip or I want to give something, tell them, listen, we're just trying to share the love of Christ, and Christ didn't have a tip jar next to the cross, and neither do we. So enjoy your free car wash, all right? So this is the deal, man. So next week we have sign-up. The way these Love Day works, we're going to have a sign-up Sunday. That project for Love Day is not just for life groups. It's for all of us. See, the life group leaders and their groups, they organize and structure these groups, plan it all out. Then they'll have sign-up sheets and invite all of you to be part of it. So it's a whole church-wide thing. Now remember, focused, aligned, and involved. My prayer is that all 700-800 of you show up that Saturday. You imagine if we all head out there and we share the love of Christ that day. Like, make it a point. Prioritize it. Let's align. Focus. Vision 2020. Let's do it. Like, put in your calendar right now. Next week, we're going to sign you up. You can choose what activity you want to be a part of. And listen, align with us. And let's fulfill the vision that God has for our church. So, church, Here it is, right? We have telling others about Jesus, bringing them to church, and outreach, serving on an outreach. This is how we do evangelism here at Elevate Church. This is our strategy. We need to be focused. All life group leaders, make sure you fulfill a community service project every semester this year. Let's be focused. Let's be aligned, everyone working together. And let's be involved, all of us, as an army for Christ, serving him together. This is our strategy. So listen, on your seats, you found a little Lego piece, and I'm asking you guys to take it with you as a reminder of the vision and of the role that you are called to play to fulfill the vision that God has. When you think about Legos, it's something that's put together, a vision that's made up of a bunch of small pieces. And listen, together we make up a vision that God has for Elevate Church to see Christ elevated in this community. All of you play a role in that. So I want you to take these Lego pieces home as a reminder, to remind you that you individually are part of something greater, something bigger in your lives. This will serve as a reminder. I am a piece that I specifically fulfill. I play a role in something greater that God is designing and building here at Elevate Church. That Lego piece is there to remind you that God has a specific purpose for you to play in this church and in this vision and mission. Elevate Church. Everybody, you have a purpose here. Let that piece be a reminder as well that God has a specific place where you fit in the vision that God has given here at Elevate Church. You know, it doesn't matter the shape of these Legos, the colors, or the, listen, each Lego fits specifically somewhere. And if you are saved, called, and this is your church home, God has specifically placed you and designed you with your spiritual gifts and your backgrounds. And you have a specific place that God wants you to fulfill here at Elevate Church. And that piece, I want you to take it home to remind you that without you, we cannot fully fulfill the vision that God has over Elevate Church. Focus, alignment, and involvement. And at the end, here's my favorite part. The glory goes to Jesus. Amen? It's not about a pastor or a church. This is for God's glory. This is what he died for. Amen, church? Is that a worthy cause? Amen? Amen? Are you guys with me, right? Amen? Church, the Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world. Not just a few. He loved the world. The wise, the great, the noble, the poor, the brokenhearted. He loved the whole world. Elevate Church, do you? He loved the world. It didn't matter who, no matter their sin, their background. He loved us all. So much so that he did whatever it took to bridge the gap between God and man, to save us back to himself. He loved the world that much that he was willing to do whatever it took. Do you love the world that much? Do you love your family that much? Your community that much? Let's do it together. Jesus says you will know them by their love. Let them know us. If God so loved the world, then let us love the world as well. Let us do whatever it takes to save as many people as we can for his glory. Now here's a message that I have just for those who are visiting. If you're here for the very first time or you've been... If you've never connected with Christ in a relationship, one of the things that's a little frustrating about or a little stressful about Legos sometimes is when you lose a piece. Has that ever happened to you? That happened to me recently. Me and my boys were building some Legos, and we lost one piece after Christmas. You know, and so, you know, I had some days off, so we were looking. It took us days. We cleaned the house. We picked up all the Legos, organized all the boxes. We looked under the chairs, on everywhere to find this one piece. And we couldn't find it for days, but we didn't stop trying. And several days later, we finally found that missing piece. How much joy it brought us to find that piece and finally plug it in. And now it was complete. Man, let me tell you, if you've been running from God, man, don't be a missing piece. God has created you, designed you for a specific role, man. He has a purpose for your life. That story reminds me of a parable that Jesus taught. where he had a shepherd had 100 sheep, but one was lost. And he abandoned the 99 and did whatever he could. He wouldn't sleep until he found that lost sheep. Man, if you're distant from God, it doesn't matter your sins, how far you've traveled, the places you've been, it doesn't matter. God is looking for you. It reminds me of the garden when Adam and Eve sinned. They were ashamed that they were hiding from God. And God was looking for them in the garden. And he was saying, Adam, where are you? I don't know where you're at or where you're at with your life, how far you've traveled from God. But if you don't have a relationship with him, he loves you. And by his spirit through his word, I pray that he will call out to you saying, Adam, where are you? And I invite you today to come back to the shepherd of your soul and trust Jesus as your Savior. Let us pray. Father, we thank you so much for this word. God, I pray if there's anyone here who has never trusted you as your Savior, that today will be that day. If you're listening to my voice, and I want to ask you to pray, I'm going to ask the church to pray. Here's my message to you, man. If you feel distant from God, if you've never trusted him as your Savior, he's seeking you out. Like I said earlier, the problem between God and man is sin. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All of us, starting with me. It makes no sense to pretend we're good enough. We already saw earlier that as good as you try to be, we all fall short. The Bible says there's a consequence for sin. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. What we deserve because of our sin is death and separation from God. The only place that's separate from God in all of eternity is hell. That's what my sin deserves. That's what all of our sin deserves. But here's the good news. It doesn't have to be that way. That same verse that says the wages of sin is death also says, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And that's what I want to invite you to receive today. You're wondering, how does that work? Well, what is the consequence of sin? It's death. What did Jesus come and do? He came to die on the cross for your sin. Now you might be thinking, how do I receive that? How can my sins be forgiven? How can I have eternal life with Christ? You have to believe. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son so that, here it is, whoever believes in him will not perish, will not be judged, but will have everlasting life in heaven. You have to believe and you have to step out in faith. Believe that Jesus, when he died, he absorbed all of the consequences of your sin. That he was punished so that you can be forgiven. That he died so that you can live forever. So today I want to invite you to trust Jesus as your Savior for the forgiveness of all of your sins and for eternal life in heaven. And the way you're going to respond is in a couple of seconds, I'm just going to invite you to raise up your hand. That's it. And after you raise up your hand, I'm just going to pray for you. So here's the invitation. If you would like to trust Jesus as your Savior for the forgiveness of all of your sins and for eternal life in heaven, raise up your hand right now real quick. I just want to pray for you. God bless you. I see your hand. God bless you. I see three hands here in the front. God bless you, ladies. Best decision you could ever make. Anybody else, just raise up your hand where you're at. I just want to pray for you. God bless you. I see a new hand here in the back. Awesome decision. Anyone else that wants to make this decision, just trust Jesus. Receive his grace. God bless you. I see another hand here in the center. Anybody else would like to trust Jesus as their Savior? If you're watching online, man, we're going to pray this prayer. If you're sitting in the overflow, raise up your hand back there where you're at. We have ushers that'll acknowledge you. Anybody else in this room that would like to trust Jesus? Si hay alguien que está escuchando a través de la traducción en español y quisiera creer en Jesús como su Salvador, levante su mano. Quiero orar por usted. Simplemente quiero orar. Hay alguien más. Anyone else that would like to trust Jesus, just raise up their hand. This is what we're going to do now. We're going to pray this prayer. If you raise up your hand, pray this prayer after. Repeat it after me out loud. If you're watching from the overflow, pray this prayer after me out loud. If you're watching on Facebook or in the internet in the future, wherever you're at, pray this prayer. And trust Jesus. It's not about the prayer, I promise you. It's about your faith calling out to Jesus. Pray this prayer with all sincerity, calling upon the name of the Lord. Repeat after me. Dear Heavenly Father, I admit I am a sinner and that I am separate from you and that I don't deserve heaven. But I believe that Jesus came for me, that he lived the life I could not live. And he died the death that I should have died. He paid for my sins on that cross. And on the third day, I believe he resurrected, that he conquered my sin and my death. Save me, Jesus. I believe. I call upon your name. Give me everlasting life. Give me your Holy Spirit. I will follow you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen, church. God bless you guys. Congratulations to all of you who made the best decision ever. Church, don't forget about the New Life in Christ cards. On your way out, get as many as you need. If you need more, come and see me. We have them in English and Spanish. We love you guys.
Awesome, awesome. Good morning, everyone. That was a good message, huh? Happy 2020. As the ushers come around and receive this morning's offerings, I have a few things to say to everyone here today. Of course, welcome to our church. Isn't Sunday just the best day of the week? It's my favorite day of the week, that's for sure. If you made a decision for Christ, or if you want to connect with us and make, or may have made a different type of decision, connection cards are the way to get to know each other or get to know them. So behind the seat in front of you, you will find these cards. We call these connect cards. And in these cards at the bottom, you have a bottom section that says, commit my life to Christ. So if you raised your hand to receive Christ as your Savior, we want to know. We want to congratulate you. We want to make sure that we are aware to help out. There's also a way to check mark, be baptized, connect with a life group, become a member. Whatever the case is, connection cards are definitely the way to go. And once you have these completed, you can take it to the red tent. It's right in the front. That's our connect tent. Somebody with a red shirt will be there ready to greet you and just to help you out in any way related to this. What else is happening? Life group started again. This week we had life group. Who joined us this week at some point, right? We had a packed house. Over 500 of us were here. We want everybody to be here. We just began this week, okay? So it is definitely not too late to join a life group. Life groups happen all week long at 7 o'clock here at our church. There's also one online at 8:30 p.m. on Thursdays in case a 7 doesn't work out here. There's even life groups in Español on Wednesday nights. I mean, we have life groups for everything. Married couples, for kids all week long. Children are coming here and also getting a lesson. Men, women, our students, our youth, just everyone for the family as well, even that on Friday nights. So make sure that you do come on board and connect to one of our life groups. And if you have any more questions about that or which one to join, you can also ask in the red tent, which is a connect tent. So those are a few things that are happening. And of course, our love day is coming on. Lewis talked a little bit about it. Love week is a week of Valentine's, so that's easy to remember. And that Saturday would be love day that morning. Next Sunday, we're going to have Sign Up Sunday for Love Day. And the way that it works out is that we'll have all the different projects all settled outside, and you can kind of take a look to see what are these projects so that you can plug into one of them, okay? Great things are coming here at our church, and we definitely don't want you to miss it. And of course, last but not least, our team player of the week is Marlene Perez. She is with us every week. She is part of our volunteer support group, and what that means is that this is a group of men and women that basically feed our volunteers. We have men and women here earlier than 7 o'clock in the morning till 3, 4 in the afternoon. I mean, you name it, all. Talk about a work day on Sunday mornings, right? Or Sunday during the day. So we really need to be fed, right? So if you can cook, or you can even volunteer with this team by just donating money, and we just order food and cater it in. There's so many ways to help. Make sure you pass by the red tent again if you want any more information, or you can even look for myself and I'll happily help out. Why don't we stand up and thank God for this morning and pray together to close this service as we thank God for another great Sunday. Dear God, we thank you so much for this morning. We thank you for this day, for this time that we can gather, for this time that we can come and just continue to learn about your word. Talk about vision for 2020. We want to live lives with purpose. Help us do that, Lord. We thank you for being that gap on that bridge, for providing a way for us to get to know you and be connected to you, Lord. Thank you so much. Thank you for the tithes and the offerings. May it be always to grow your kingdom, and may it always glorify your name. Help us come back this week to our life groups and connect to our church and our friends that are here by our side. Thank you, Lord, again for this day. In Jesus' name we all pray. Amen. Have an awesome Sunday, everyone. See ya.
Joy overwhelming is running right through my veins.